Good evening and welcome. Open those blue celebration hymnals to 757. Soon and very soon, 757. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. A few pages forward to 777, when we all get to heaven. Sorry, 772. 772.
When we hold Thank you, ladies. That should wake you up. You know that last song when she announced the other number? I turned right to the page where it was, and so I told Joel I was psychic. He said, hey, you keep coming. I'm going to talk on that in a couple of nights. So I think he's going to set me straight. Just a reminder, if you've been here 5 nights, you get the Bible Promise book. Did anybody get one tonight? All right. You know, I had an interesting experience at 12:30 this morning. I was visiting a family who, one of the gentlemen in the family had just passed away, and I had an opportunity to use many of these Bible promises. And so it was nice to have the book where I could look up some that fit just for that family and what they were going through. So it's a beautiful little book to have. And so keep coming 5 nights and you can get that one. And then the beautiful Bible, this really is a nice Bible, a beautiful edition like that. And like I said, if the print's too small for you to read, give it to the younger generation because they can read it. And they don't need the light that we need to read. And then 15 nights with the Strong's Concordance. So we want to encourage you to come for that. Tomorrow evening, afterwards, be prepared to stay. We're going to have an apple social. We've had several members take apples home, or people take apples home and make different apple dishes. I made something too, but I'm not going to tell you what it is because you won't eat it if you. I think Roberta's been in a wheelchair for a couple months now. And she hasn't been able to cook, and I've been doing all the cooking. She's going to be so glad to get something different. Now, a couple of church members have brought things over, which has been very helpful. But we want you to come tomorrow evening. It's just an opportunity to get together and socialize and enjoy some good food and dessert, and I think you'll enjoy yourself. As we continue on this evening, Tanya, would you come up and share our theme song with us?
Marvelous message we bring, glorious carol we sing, wonderful words of the King. Jesus is coming again, coming again, coming again. Maybe morning, maybe noon, maybe evening, but sure.
Well, look at all of you. Praise the Lord. And you're smiling, every one of you, I think. That's fantastic. I like that. It's not good when you stand up here and nobody's smiling, you see. Then you wonder how long you really want to stay up here. See? But when you're smiling like this, it makes me kind of want to stay here a little extra longer tonight. But we're going to go through some fantastic things this evening. We're going to be talking about the revealing of the Antichrist, and we're going to be learning some tremendous prophetic tools that you can use to understand the scriptures as you study yourself, because the Bible is something that you and I, just as lay people, you don't need somebody scholarly to tell you what it means. If you really dig into it, the Bible is written so that you can understand it, and God's given you everything you need to know in scripture. And so I'm just going to show you some of the keys to that, so when you're studying the Bible, you can understand it just as well as I can. And then one of these days, you can come up here and do this instead of me. Right? Amen. I didn't hear too many amens, but that's okay. We're going to take a quiz from the night before, though. We talked about the second coming of Jesus, the very literal aspect of it. We talked about how it's going to happen, because when Jesus came the first time, they were looking for him to come in a different manner, remember? They weren't looking for Jesus to come the way he did. They were looking for him to come in a different manner, so it made a difference. And Jesus told us we had to be wary and be careful that we were not deceived, because we're going to see some things coming. And they said that he might be here, or he might become in the secret place. And they said, no, he said, don't believe him. So let's take a look at the quiz questions from the other night. The secret rapture theory being taught today is not taught in the Bible. It's a misinterpretation of scripture. Was that true or false? That's true. It's false. It's true that the theory is false. I know, it's kind of confusing. But what we saw when we looked at the Bible is when Jesus returns, upon his return, there's a lot of things happening. You know, you look at Peter, the idea of the thief, you know, when Jesus comes as a thief, he may show up as a thief because they weren't watching him. Remember, there were scoffers not looking forward to the coming. But what happened when Jesus came? The islands fled away. He came with fire and a tempest around him, and the earth and the works therein were burnt up and all of those things. A lot of things happened when Jesus comes. So you're not going to, if you're not watching for him, he's going to come as a thief, like unannounced. You were unaware he was coming. But for those of us who are watching and waiting, we're looking for it. We're waiting for it. We're seeing the signs. It's not going to come upon us as a thief. That's what Paul told his disciples, or the other believers. He said, look, this day doesn't have to come upon you unawares, because you know ahead of time. You know the signs. You can see and you can watch. It will not approach you as a thief. And so we see in the Bible, we saw all sorts of different issues with that accordingly. Quiz question number 2. 5 great facts are found regarding how Jesus will come. Can you name them? Somebody tell me one. Literal, yep. What? Oh, yeah, it's going to be, yep, you're going to hear it, so it's going to be visible. What about this one? It's going to be audible, right? We're going to hear trumpets blasting. The Bible says every eye shall see him. I got a hand here. Glorious, yep, it's going to be glorious. He's coming with all the glory of the Father and the glory of all the angels, and it's going to be climactic, which means it's going to be the end of the world as we know it. The Bible depicts tremendous destruction when Jesus comes, but not for those who believe in Jesus, of course, because the Bible says we who are alive and remain, the Bible in 2 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17, it says, the Lord shall himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord, where? Not in Jerusalem? No, it says in the air. That's what the Bible says. We're going to meet Jesus in the air forever to be with the Lord. So we're going to meet him together with all those who have died before, meet Jesus in the air, and then we're going to go to be with Jesus. And that all happens, like Paul says in 1 Corinthians, in the twinkling of an eye. So fantastic. We're going to touch that verse here in a few nights. Quiz question number 3. When Jesus comes to rapture all his people, the wicked will remain on earth and receive a second chance to be saved. True or false? False. There's nothing left when Jesus comes second time. Earth is... Well, we're going to find out how devastated earth is once Jesus returns. So, tonight we're going to talk about false Christs and the time of the Antichrist. We're going to go through some scripture. We're going to learn some prophetic keys to understanding prophecy, because the Bible is filled with patterns and it's filled with you know, similarities, these recurring themes in scripture. We're going to talk later on, not tonight, but later on, we're going to talk about typology, which is another way of understanding Scripture. It helps us because God is very consistent throughout Scripture. He keeps showing us things over and over and over and over again, so we understand the characteristics of things. We understand the character of God throughout all of these things. We understand the character and the characteristics of the enemy, of Satan as well, through all these different things. So we're going to see these over and over and over, and God does this in a repetitive form. And we see that also when we look in the book of Revelation. Revelation is like this seven, you know, you might see these cycles, 7 different cycles of Revelation within the book of Revelation, visions coming back and the covering of same ground again and covering the same ground again, and we're going to get into that later on. But tonight we're going to talk about false Christs and the time of the Antichrist, and we're going to start revealing the identity of the Antichrist according to Scripture. Okay, according to Scripture. So tonight, before we do this, because we're going to open God's Word, I'm going to ask the Lord to be with us, to help ask the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us in our understanding and in our reading of the Word, and I invite you to bow your head and pray with me as well. Father in heaven, thank you so much. Lord, you've given us another opportunity to open your word together. And Lord, we know that there's a promise in your word, which we believe with all of our heart and our souls. It says, there were two or more are gathered, there you are in their midst. And so, Lord, we know that you're here with us, for we're gathering in your name. We're here to open your word, which you've given to us, Lord, that we might understand. Like you told your servant Daniel, that we can understand, that we might be able to know and understand the vision and the prophecies that are in this book. And so, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would move upon us and give us the understanding that we need. Let our eyes be eyes that see and ears to hear and hearts to understand your word tonight. As we open your scriptures, we pray for the guidance of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we just thank you that we have an opportunity to do it together. And in Jesus' name we come to you. Amen. All right. False Christs and false prophets would come. Jesus says that very thing in Matthew 24:24. Let's start there in Matthew 24. The book of Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew. We've been in Matthew 24 quite some time because it's such a the chapter is just filled with issues about the end of time. But in Matthew chapter 24, in verse 24, the Bible says, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders," that's miracles, "insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect." I made mention of this the other night. We're all Bible-believing. Most of us are holding a Bible right now because we just got done reading it. Most of us are Bible-believing Christians, and we're not too easily deceived by maybe somebody running around in a witch costume saying, well, you have to believe in witchcraft and not God, or an atheist saying you don't have to believe in God at all, or a New Ager who's running around saying, well, you know, God is everything. You know, you are God too, and all these kind of things. We are not so easily apt to be taken away by things that are way out of bounds of Christianity. Are you? I don't think I am. I mean, I'm not going to be fooled by occultism telling me that the Bible isn't true, because I believe the Bible. I believe God. So how is the devil going to raise up people to deceive those who are holding on to the Scripture unless he deceives you within the religious realm, right? Because he's not going to deceive you out there. He's going to deceive you in here. And so you have to be wary. You and I have to be wary. We have to be watchful. We have to be attentive to what we are being taught, what we are hearing, and we have to be checking it with the Word of God, which is why I've been encouraging you sometimes overnight and night after night, saying, look, don't take my word for it. Go home and check out what the Bible says. Read the Bible for yourself. Okay, so I'm showing you what the Bible is saying. I'm telling you, I'm preaching and I'm teaching. But I want you to go home and reread the Bible and take the notes that we send and go over Scripture and find more Scripture and do your due diligence. Like the Bible says, be a good Berean, right? The Bereans were more noble than all the rest, Paul says in Acts. He says, because they received the word with gladness and took it to heart, but they went home and they opened the Scriptures to see if those things were so. And not just so, we don't just want to receive the word with gladness, we want to go home and make sure what we hear is so. And so I encourage you, go home and study the Bible. Take the Scriptures and open them up. Because the Bible tells us, and Jesus himself says, there are going to come such deceptions, even miracles, that are not of God. So much so that they will deceive even the very elect, if possible. You might think, well, how in the world can that happen? Well, the Bible tells us how that happens, and it happens in the church. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 14 through 15, but you know the devil goes to church too. It says, "For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." So the devil himself portrays himself as this angel of light, an angel of truth, you might say, an angel from God. He's saying, look, I have the truth. And there's many people out in the world, sometimes they'll meet this angel of light because they're dabbling in the occult, and they think, wow, this bright and shining being came and spoke to me. Hey, folks, it wasn't the Lord. It was the devil transforming himself into an angel of light. And the verse finishes in verse 15. It says, "Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness." You know, the devil has ministers too. The devil has ministers, and they transform themselves, not all of them. Some of them are perfectly happy being satanic priests, right? And Luciferian priests and all those kind of things. But some of them, the ones the devil has control over, whatever, for whatever purpose, whatever reason, they are transformed into ministers of righteousness in order to get those and do catch those who might be able to be snared from within the flock of God, because they teach deception, and they teach false teachings. And so this is what it says: those ministers of righteousness, their end is going to be according to their works. So we have to be careful, don't we? So how in the world do you know if you're being deceived or if you have the truth, right? That's a hard thing to know. Well, really, I mean, if you're just sitting there trying to contemplate it logically, because deceived people don't know they're deceived, right? The thinking of a deceived person is, I'm not deceived. That's the way deceived people think. They think they have it. So our only safeguard, your only hope of knowing what the truth is the Bible. That's it. It's the revealed word and will of God. You can't believe signs and wonders because the Bible says there's going to be ministers of Satan doing signs and wonders. So just because somebody's doing signs and wonders and miracles and wonderful things seem to be happening wherever they may be, it may look churchy, but if it's not according to the Word of God, see, we have to check everything. We have to check everything, check the teaching, check the fruit, check all these things. Make sure it's according to the Word of God. The Word of God reveals the truth, and it exposes error. And tonight we're going to see that the Word of God reveals the Antichrist. It gives us multiple criteria. Boom, 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 boom. We're going to look at 15 identifying characteristics that identify the Antichrist. And the Antichrist, whoever you may have in mind, has to fit every single one. The Antichrist can't fit just a couple here and a couple there, and half of them don't fit. No, no, no. God is particular. God is very exact. He says, look, it's going to fit everyone. The Antichrist is like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all the way to 15. He says, this is the way it is. And if your theory of the Antichrist doesn't fit that because it's biblical, then you have to put them off to the side and say, oh, that's not the Antichrist. It has to be somebody else because it has to be exact. So the Bible, it reveals the Antichrist, and it's exposing them because of the false teachings, okay? And that's very important. God is exposing the Antichrist at the end of time because of false teaching, false doctrines, if you will. And the Bible is very particular. God is very particular about doctrine. Matter of fact, in Timothy, it tells us that God has a doctrine. It's God's doctrine that the Bible tells us about. And a doctrine is just a word that says a teaching about Jesus, a teaching about God is what that means. And so we want to know which it is because God wants us to know because he doesn't want us to be led astray. Remember the word deceive? Remember the word planao in Greek? Some of you were here that night. The word planao, where Jesus says, don't let anybody deceive you, means to be caused to roam away from safety, virtue, and truth. Okay, so the devil is out to deceive you, to cause you to roam away from safety, from virtue, and from truth. Essentially, to roam away from the Word of God. So this is the revealed will of God. And so we're going to understand this tonight. So let's go to the book of Revelation chapter 1. Oh, I feel like I've preached already. Revelation chapter 1. But we're just starting. That was the intro. We're good. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ. Whose revelation is it? It's Jesus' revelation, right? It's not John's. Some people say, well, it's the revelation of John. No, no, no. John got it. John received it and wrote it down, but it's the revelation of Jesus. Jesus was the one. This is Jesus' revelation. Jesus speaking to John through signs and visions and wonders here. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. It's interesting that he sent it and he signified it, or you might say signified it, which means he put it into symbolic form. So the book of Revelation is symbolic. You might have guessed that if you've ever read it, right? Because we're going to read some chapters and you think, boy, if that's literal, I'm scared, right? Because I was when I was young. I'm going to read that passage to you. It scared the living daylights out of me when I'd read it when I was young because I thought it was all literal. But the Bible tells us right there that Revelation is a symbolic book. He signified it. He signified it. It was put in symbol form for us. And then it says something very interesting in Revelation 1:19. It says, write the things which thou hast seen, and things which are, and things which shall be hereafter. John is told, look, I want you to write the things that you have seen, things in the past. I want you to think things which are in the present, and I want you to write the things that were going to be in the future. So the book of Revelation is not all in the future for John. Some of it is history for John. Some of it is present day for John, and some of it is future for John. So when we look at the book of Revelation, are we going to see something in the past? We should, because God said he's going to write things of the past. Are we going to see some of the things that were maybe present day for John? Sure, that would be still past for us, wouldn't it? I think so. Yeah, that would be past for us. And then are we very likely to see some things that are yet future, not only for John, but future for us as well? Sure, we're going to see all three things as well. We're going to see past, present. We're actually going to see some things that are present when we're studying this. And that might scare you, but we are going to see present prophecies fulfilled as we are almost daily while we're sitting here. We're seeing prophecies fulfilled. Within the last few months, we've seen prophecies of Revelation fulfilled. We are seeing them develop. Just as we are studying the Bible, you are going to see past, present prophecies and future prophecies. And I guarantee you, it's going to make your eyes get really big. No, you're going to be shocked. You're going to say, wow, I didn't know we were this close to when Jesus returns. Because there's not a lot of revelation left to happen, folks. Most of it is done. Most of it is done. And so Revelation 1:19 tells us past, present, and future in Revelation. Not just past, not just present, not just future. It's all three. And so let's take a look at Revelation 14. Revelation 14. Book of Revelation 14. We talked a little bit about this first angel in Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 and 7 here a few nights back. We talked a little bit about that. We're going to come back to that a little bit later again. But in verse 8, we see a second angel. These three angels in Revelation 14 are three messages to the world before Jesus comes. Okay, God is sending out messages to the world, all the world. Remember in verse 6, it says, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. This book and messages are not limited to Israel or Jews. It's not limited to the Russians. It's not limited to the Syrians or the Americans or anybody like that. It's to everybody on the face of the earth. God wants everyone to know what's happening. And so he sends out this message to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. And in verse 8, there's a second message that comes still to those same people. And it says, and there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel, now there's a third angel. The third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night who worship the beast in his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. So here's a very fearful warning that God gives us with these two messages. He says, look, he says, Babylon is fallen. We're going to study that tonight. Because Babylon in the Revelation is referring to the Antichrist power of Daniel and the son of perdition of 2 Thessalonians. And this beast power that we're going to be studying in Revelation 13 is this power that Revelation is speaking of here, Babylon. And Babylon is fallen, it says. And so we're going to study that. But it says very importantly that Babylon is fallen, but if anybody worships the image or takes the mark of the beast, so they're going to be lost. So in order to know what the mark is and to not worship the way they are, then we also have to know what the identity of the beast is as well, don't we? We have to know the identity, otherwise how are we going to know the mark? Otherwise, we're just in the land of confusion, and God doesn't leave us in a land of confusion in His Word. He's telling us so that we might know, right? He's telling us so that we don't have to go through life saying, I have no idea what the mark of the beast is. I have no idea who the Antichrist is going to be. Look, what I'm telling you tonight is nothing new. Matter of fact, I'm going to tell you something that's so old that people have forgotten it was ever taught before. But it's the truth of the Bible. And it's something that God has wanted the world to know ever since He revealed these books to us so that we might understand how things are going to happen during the end days, which we, friends, are living in right now. And so we have these great happenings at the end of time. Babylon has fallen, and there's going to be this mark, and we have to avoid the mark, or we're going to be lost. That doesn't sound like a good end for those who take the mark. We don't want to be those kind of people, so we want to be on the other side of that issue. So we have to understand who are the players there, and God gives us very distinct understanding. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, the Bible says, let no man deceive you by any means. For that day shall not come, speaking of the second coming of Jesus, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. So the Bible says distinctly that first, before Jesus returns, the Antichrist is going to be revealed. So the Antichrist is going to rise up and be in power before Jesus comes, okay? So that's very important because a lot of theories out there say that Jesus comes, takes the church out, and then the Antichrist arises, but that's not how it happens. Jesus comes after the Antichrist has been raised up. Listen to what it says. That son of perdition be revealed, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. You know, a lot of people, they like to think that the end time issues and the idea about the Antichrist rising up is some, it's all about political power, it's about military power, it's about economics and all these kind of things. And those things have issues within it, but the whole issue at the end of time has nothing to do with political power or economic power or popularity or anything like that. You know what it has to do with? That word that's underlined, worship. It has to do with worship. Because that's what the devil is after all along, was worship. If we look, you know, and so people have misunderstood that, and they've applied all sorts of ideas to who might the Antichrist be. So some people think George W. Bush was the Antichrist, and he didn't fit the bill. Some people thought President Gorbachev was. You remember those days? Because he had that birthmark on his head, and they thought that was where the wound was, and they thought he was the Antichrist, but he didn't fit any of the criteria of the Bible. Some people thought Muammar Gaddafi was the Antichrist. Of course, now he's long gone, and passed on. The head of the UN, a lot of people think that's the Antichrist power, but that doesn't fit the biblical spectrum either. Or maybe Adolf Hitler. A lot of people in the day thought Adolf Hitler had to be the Antichrist. Okay, no doubt he was led by Satan, right? But he wasn't the Antichrist. So, but they have all these secular ideas of who the Antichrist may be because they have this idea that the Antichrist is against the Bible altogether. It's going to show up against God. But that's not what the word means. Antichrist, oh, that's another one I forgot, Prince Charles. I always think that one's kind of funny. I don't know why. I can't see Prince Charles being the Antichrist, you know? It just doesn't fit. Well, in the rest of the Bible, he doesn't fit either, so I'm sure he's happy he's not the Antichrist. But the Antichrist, the word comes from antichristos, which means in place of, instead of, or in behalf of Christ. So it does not mean against Christ. You know, we always think anti-plaque is against plaque, right? Or anti-something, it's always against. But the Bible means instead of or in place of, which is the character of the devil. Because when you look at what the devil wanted to do, he wanted to put himself in the place of God. He wants to be instead of Christ. We're going to see how much of a thief he is because he tries to put himself where Jesus should be, not only in the world, not only in worship, but in your heart and in your life as well. But so the devil is, he's the spirit of Antichrist comes from Satan, but he's trying to put himself in place of, in behalf of, or instead of Christ. So it makes sense that it's going to be something and someone in a religious realm. Doesn't that make sense? That makes sense? Because it's going to appear to be in the stead of or in place of Christ. And so that's where it's coming from. And so we have to look at what the words really mean in Scripture to get a full understanding of who this Antichrist person is going to be. Revelation chapter 14. I don't know if your Bible is open there. Turn there again. I'll show you the issue of worship. Revelation 14, verses 6 and 7 and 9, 11. God's calling to the end of time, the people of the world at the end of time. There in verse 7, he says, saying with loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him that made heaven and earth, sea and the fountains of waters. And in verse 9, he's talking about the beast power. He says, and the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive the mark of his forehead. And in verse 11, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they that have no rest or day or night who worship the beast and his image. The issue at the end of time is worship. Matter of fact, when you look at the characteristics of the Antichrist power and that second beast power that helps him, we're going to study that too in chapter 13. You see worship used all the time. In verse 4 of chapter 13 there in Revelation, it says, they worship the dragon which gave power unto the beast, and they worship the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? And again in verse 8, it says, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. In verse 12, it says that he exercises all the power of the first beast before him and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship. And again in verse 15, he had power to give life unto the image of the beast. The image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as should not worship the image of the beast should be killed. It's kind of clear when you read those things that are happening at the time, the issue is worship, don't you think? Because what's the issue with God? God wants to be first in your heart, first in your life, because he's God. He created you. He redeemed you. He's coming to deliver you if you believe in him. If you put your faith in him, if you make him your Savior and your Lord. And the issue is worship. And the devil wants to have the worship. He desires to put himself in the place of God. That was the whole rebellion in heaven was about worship. The devil wanted the worship and all the adoration and all the power that God had, but he wanted nothing to do with the character of God. He wanted the worship of all the beings. He wanted the power and the authority that God had. But he wanted to put himself in the place of God. He wanted to sit on the sides of the north. He wanted to sit there, which is the place where God judges from. He wanted to be the judge, the lawgiver, if you will. Isaiah 28, 9 and 10. This is why we have to study the Bible. It says, "Whom shall he teach knowledge? To whom shall he make understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breasts. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little." What does that mean? Sounds like God's being repetitive. He's being repetitive for a very, very important purpose. He says, look, you need to study the Bible, and you need to look at this verse, and look at that verse, and look at this verse, and look at that verse, and put all of the verses together that talk about the issue that you're studying. Because one verse here and one verse there, when you leave out the rest, does not give you a good enough picture of what you're studying. And so what we want to do is study the entire Scripture. You want to study from the Old Testament all the way to the New. We looked at the other night, you can't understand the New Testament unless you understand the Old Testament. The Old Testament has not gone away. It's enveloped and it's embodied in the New, and if you don't understand the Old, the New is going to be meaningless to you. It's the same way with Revelation. If you don't understand the Old Testament, you're not going to understand Revelation. And so we're going to see that these technically, that page in between Old and New Testament that says New Testament in your Bible, you could tear that out because it's not inspired. What you should do is just say silence for 400 years from God, okay? Because it's one testament. God has been only spoke to his people through the Word of God, and so you have Old Testament, New Testament, but it's just all this. It's all the message from God. And so the testament, the word testament is really put in there by us. So it's really the Word of God, period, right? The Word of God, period, is what we need to follow. Amos 3:7, "Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secrets unto his servants the prophets." So is God going to come at the end of time and show us all the things that are, or he's not going to show us all the things that are going to happen? Or does the Bible tell us that God's going to let us know the things that are going to happen before he comes? It says he's going to let us know. He's going to reveal his secrets unto his servants, the prophets, and his prophets wrote it down, and so we can read it and understand it, so we can know, right? Because God doesn't want you ignorant. He doesn't want you bewildered. That's the whole definition of being deceived, ignorance and bewilderment. And so he doesn't want us that way. So let's go to Revelation chapter 13, one of that text that scared the living daylights out of me when I was about 10, 11 years old. And I read this, and I thought, oh, this can't be true. But here it is. These first 10 verses describe the Antichrist power. It's called a beast, okay? Beginning in verse 1 of chapter 13, "I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth was the mouth of a lion, and a dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority." You can see why I was shaking in my bed when I read this, right? "And I saw one of his heads as if it wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemy. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And the power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from before the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword shall must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints." So you know what that is. Now we can go home, right? No, there's all sorts of symbols in there, right? Remember, God sent it signified. When I was young, I read that we lived near a small lake, right? And I read this, and this beast is going to rise up out of the water. And I'm thinking, oh, what if it's my lake, right? Because I'm telling you the truth. I would go to bed scared. And so I decided I'm not reading Revelation anymore. And so for years, I didn't read Revelation because it's a scary book. And you know, that's happened to a lot of people, not just kids, but adults too. They read it and they look at it and say, look, this is too scary. I don't want to have nightmares. I don't even know what this means. I think I'm just going to pray that I make the right choice and head down and go forward, right? And a lot of people do that because they're afraid to read because it's scary, because you don't understand it. But if now we're going to study it, we're going to understand it, it's not going to be scary to you anymore. I guarantee you, if you're scared of Revelation now, you won't be when we're done. And then you can help somebody else be unscared later on, because you're going to understand what the Bible's saying. Revelation here, this is talking about this beast out of the sea. So when we look at it, John says, I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea. So this is all symbolic, right? So John is looking at a sea, and we have to say, well, what does a sea represent? Because this is where this beast is coming from. Well, the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 17, verse 15, what a sea is in prophecy, what water is in prophecy. The Bible says, and he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest where the horse sitteth are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. So when you see waters in prophecy, in symbolic prophecy, they're a symbol of many people. Populated areas, you might say. All these peoples, nations, kindreds, and tongues. All this population of area, this concentrated populated area. That's what the water means. And so that helps. The beast rises up out of these populated areas. So now we have to understand what beasts are. So we have to go back to the book of Daniel. And you're like, why are we leaving Revelation so quick? Because Daniel and Revelation are companion books. Remember I told you, you can't understand the New Testament unless you understand the Old? You cannot understand Revelation unless you read Daniel. And you will not fully understand Daniel unless you read Revelation. They're companion books. They both deal with end time events. Daniel had visions, John had visions. Those visions are comparable. They lay on top of one another. You see them, you put them together, and it fills in all the question marks. And you can see that. And so when God is helping us interpret the visions of Daniel, they are helping us interpret the visions of Revelation as well. And so we're going to take a look in Daniel and see exactly what Daniel saw, because Daniel saw the same type of vision John did back in Daniel chapter 7. So take your Bible, flip over to Daniel chapter 7. This is why the Bible is exciting. You can go from one to another, and it just fills in, and it fills in, and it fills in. And you just keep studying, and you're like, wow, I didn't realize that. This is talking about the same thing it is over there. And then pretty soon you're reading farther along. It's like, wow, this is talking about what it's said in that book. And the Bible just keeps fitting together tighter and tighter, like a beautifully woven tapestry. And the Bible is not something that can be torn apart. But Daniel chapter 7, verses 2 through 4. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great, what? Sea, right? So he's striving upon the sea. So there's waters again, right? John saw the beast rise up out of waters, and Daniel is seeing these sea, those waters. And it says, and four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. So Daniel sees four beasts. John only saw one, right? John saw a beast rise up. But Daniel sees four. Now wait, we're gonna find out how they fit together. Verse 4. The first was like a lion, the second and had eagle's wings. I beheld the wings were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand upon the And it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, this is the second one, second like unto a bear. And it raised itself up on one side, and it had three ribs in its mouth, and between the teeth of it. And they said unto this, arise, devour much flesh. And after this, and lo, another, like a leopard, the third one, had on the back of it four wings of a fowl, and the beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. And verse 7 says, and after this I saw in the night vision, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, so much so he can't even describe it really with any other beast he can see in the world. And he said, and had a great iron teeth, it devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And so Daniel sees four beasts where John saw one, but look at the similarities of these visions. Remember, John was seeing, what did the Bible say? God said, write down what you have seen, what is present, and what is future. John is looking in the past. Daniel is looking into the future. And so Daniel sees four beasts rise. He sees a lion, and then he sees a bear, and then he sees a leopard, and then he sees this nondescript dragon-like dinosaur kind of thing come out of the water. He can't describe it. He's just like, man, it's just terrible. It's got teeth like iron. And, you know, he's trying to describe it. Nothing in the world in his mind he can compare it to. And John is looking back in time, and he sees the conglomeration of these four beasts together into one beast. So what we're seeing is history brought up to John's day is where John is seeing. Now, what are these beasts? What does it mean? Well, the Bible tells us what the beast is in Daniel chapter 7, verses 17. Thankfully, the angel comes and describes it for Daniel. In Daniel chapter 7, verse 17, the Bible says, these great beasts, which are four, are four kings which shall arise out of the earth. So there are four kings, and in verse 25 it says the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom. So their kings are kingdoms. A king and a kingdom in the Bible are synonymous. You know, like Daniel said, you know, and when he talked to Nebuchadnezzar, he said, "You, Nebuchadnezzar, are the head of gold." He was in meeting the entire kingdom of Babylon that Nebuchadnezzar was ruler over. So here in the Bible it says, look, these beasts are kingdoms, okay? They're kingdoms. And so John is looking back in time, and he sees this progression of kingdoms that have risen and combined. I mean, that seems kind of strange, but that's what happened. Daniel is looking into the future. He says this. He sees one kingdom rise, and he sees another kingdom rise, and he sees another kingdom rise, and he sees this fourth kingdom rise. John looks back and sees them all pushed together, smashed into one kingdom, one beast. And there they are, this conglomeration, this, you know, it's you know, genetic modification, if you will, right? They've got parts of everything. But there it is. And so they're seeing the same vision. They're seeing it from different aspects of time. All right. So what's the lion with eagle's wings? This first beast that Daniel sees arise. The Bible tells us who the lion is in Jeremiah 50, verses 43 and 44. The king of Babylon hath heard the report of them, and his hands waxed feeble. Anguish took hold of him, and pangs of a woman. Behold, he shall come up like a lion from the swelling of Jordan into the habitation of the strong. In the Bible, oftentimes Babylon is considered this lion, and with eagle's wings especially. Matter of fact, when you go into, you look at the Ishtar Gate, that you can see this in museums. This is the gate you would have walked into had you went into Babylon, this Ishtar Gate. And it's got all these figures on it, and one of those figures depicting Babylon is a lion with eagle's wings. It was a symbol for Babylon even in those days. And so God depicts Babylon as this lion with eagle's wings. And Daniel, that makes sense for Daniel because he's living in the days of Babylon, back here in Daniel chapter 7. And so he sees Babylon rise, so he sees his kingdom. Now, we've seen another vision that started with Babylon too. Remember, who was here the first night? We talked about this vision from head to toe, right? The head of gold, chest and arms of silver, belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron, okay? Now, let's see if this holds true, because that one started with Babylon as well. What is the next one? The Daniel chapter 7, verse 5 said a bear would rise up, higher on one side, with three ribs in its mouth. And it would rise up and it would devour much flesh. What was the next kingdom that came after Babylon? It says in Daniel chapter 7, verse 5, Daniel 5, verse 28, because this one, it raised up, it would devour much flesh. The Bible tells us what the next kingdom was. In Daniel chapter 5, you see the fall of Babylon. Okay, Babylon comes, the fall of Babylon happens. Belshazzar is there, he's having this party. We went over this, remember, and Cyrus came in and destroyed the city. And it was the Medes and the Persians. It says, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. And so the bear is representative of the Medes and the Persians. And it makes sense because the Medes and the Persians were heavy on one side. They were raised up on one side, if you will, just like the bear, because the Medes and the Persians were two separate people, but they had this alliance that they would work together to fight against Babylon, but the Medes were much stronger than the Persians. It was kind of an off-balance relationship, and so that's what this is depicting. This bear is higher on one side, is stronger on one side than the other, and the Persians were much stronger than the Medes. That's why you hear Persian rugs and not Media rugs, right? Because Persian... Well, it's true. Persia was the stronger of the two, and that's why we talk of Persia and the Persian Empire and not the Median Empire. And so that's the... Now, you might say, well, what's the meaning of the ribs? Okay, so here, think about this. If a kingdom is a beast, an animal, and this bear has been out devouring much flesh, then he might have remnants of certain beasts left in his mouth of those that he has devoured, right? Does that make sense? Okay, so when Medo-Persia came to power then, how many other beasts, how many other kingdoms did they conquer to gain power? Exactly three. They conquered Lydia, Babylon, and Egypt. Lydia, Babylon, and Egypt, Medo-Persia conquered and devoured as they rose to power. And those three kingdoms, there you go, the Medo-Persian Empire was made up of Lydia, Babylon, and Egypt. Those three kingdoms they devoured, three ribs left in their mouth. So that fits exactly the way the Bible said. What about Daniel chapter 7, verse 6, this fourth beast? Fourth beast had a leopard, and it had a back on it, four wings like a fowl, which it depicts speed, much speed. And the beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. So now we have a beast that's like a leopard. Does anybody remember what kingdom followed Medo-Persia, the chest and arms of silver. Who was the belly and thighs of brass? Greece, right? Well, in the Bible, it tells us that the ram that thou sawest having two horns are the kings of Medo-Persia. This is in chapter 8. We read this the other night. And the rough goat is the king of Greece, and the great horn between his eyes is the first king. So Greece comes and conquers Medo-Persia. It said, now that being broken, that big horn between his eyes, four stood up for it. Four kingdoms shall stand up out of the nation, but not in his power. So how did that happen? Greece came along. Alexander the Great, that great conqueror, if you know history at all, you know that that was a tremendous conquering feat, that he conquered the then-known world in like 3.5 years. And he conquered it all, just tremendous power. He swept over the and speed, so you have these four wings. And when he got done, he's way over there by India, and he gets to the tradition says, or legend says, he gets to the Indian Ocean, and he looks out, and he doesn't see any more land to conquer, and he kneels down in the sand, and he weeps because there's no more war to be had, right? Because he was a man of war. And he goes back, he takes his army, and they march back, and they're camped outside of Babylon somewhere, the city of Babylon, because they had sacked it, right? And they're outside of Babylon. They're camping there, and he's depressed, and he starts drinking, and he gets so drunk that he intoxicates himself, he toxifies himself, and he dies of alcohol poisoning. And as he's laying there dying, they ask him, who will take over the kingdom? This is, you know, we don't have this in the Bible. This is Greece history, right? But they said, who will take over the kingdom? And he says, the strongest. And so his four generals fight it out. His four generals were Ptolemy, Lysimachus, Seleucus, and Cassander. And they battle it out, and the Greek Empire ends up being in four pieces. Still the Greek Empire, but it's ruled by four separate generals, a leopard with four heads, okay? And that's where it is. So Cassander, Lysimachus, Seleucus, and Ptolemy, they divide up the Grecian Empire, and yet it's still the one kingdom as a Grecian Empire, but it's divided by these four generals. The strongest would win, and none of them were exactly the strongest, so there you go. So now we have these one, two, three kingdoms in a row. You might think, well, why is God repeating himself, right? Didn't we already see this back in the timeline? We had the head of gold, chest and arms of silver, belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron. We see Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and God seems to be repeating himself over and over. He's repeated himself from Daniel 2 and Daniel 7. We see it in Daniel 8. Well, we talked about it a little bit. God repeats what he's saying, and then he expands on it. He adds more detail. And it's like we, like I said, when we learn math, you know, we don't learn math. We don't sit down in first grade and learn calculus. I mean, some of us don't even want to learn it when we're in senior high. But when you're, you know, you don't give a first grader a calculus book to do the test because they would have no idea what the symbols and the signs and the, and they wouldn't, they had no idea. You sit them down, you teach them 1 plus 1 is 2, and 2 plus 2 is 4, and 3 plus 3 is 6, and then you, and later on, you teach them subtraction, and then you teach them addition and multiplication and division and fractions, and you start working your way up, and you keep adding to what you've already taught, and you keep adding more detail, and you cover back what you've already taught. That's how God teaches us in prophecy. He repeats what he's already said and he adds more detail. And that's why because he wants us to know. He wants us to get it. If he showed us all at once, we wouldn't have any idea what these other little pieces mean because it would be calculus to us and it wouldn't be 1 plus 1. And so God gives us the 1 plus 1 and then he starts adding to it. So Daniel, in chapter 7, verse 7, he sees this fourth beast. And so we've seen Babylon, Medo-Persia, and Greece coming right down the line, just like God had been repeating it. And so Babylon was the head of gold, it was also the lion. Medo-Persia was the chest and arms of silver, it was also the bear. Greece was the belly and thighs of brass, it was also the leopard. And now we have these legs of iron, and we have a fourth beast that's this dreadful, terrible beast that's nondescript almost in the Bible. And who might you think that may be? Well, following the pattern, it would be Rome. Right, you follow the pattern of Scripture, it would be Rome, which makes sense because there's no other kingdom that fits into that timeline like Rome does. Because Rome was the next conquering kingdom, and Rome was there even in the days when Jesus was on earth, right? Rome was ruling long before and long after the time of Jesus. And Rome ruled from 168 B.C. until 476 A.D. You see it there at the height of its empire, and it covered quite a bit from the Caspian Sea and the Red Sea all the way over to the Atlantic Sea, Spain, and Britannia. I mean, it was a big kingdom for those days. That was the largest kingdom, the greatest kingdom the world had ever seen. And there it was, Rome at its height. And so we see this timeline coming down. Now you might say, I thought we were going to identify the Antichrist tonight, and you're waiting. I said, we are. But this is a very important point. We have to know the timing, okay? The timing of the Antichrist. God doesn't give us all this just so we can guess. God gives us the timeline in Daniel 2 and in Daniel 7 and in Daniel 8 so that we know the timing of everything. God doesn't just have us say, well, I don't know when this is going to happen, or we have no idea when this is going to happen. We do. God has set specific times for things. He's put in place timing so that we might know where we are in history and what we are about to face as Christians. And so we're going to see the timing of this. So we know that we've gone from Babylon to Medo-Persia to Greece. Now we're into the Roman era. And now John says, out of the 10 horns of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. What happened to the legs in iron, of iron? They disappear? Did they stay completely iron and intact, or did they start muddling together with mud, right? They started muddling together with clay, and they divided. Didn't the Bible say it wasn't going to be conquered by another country? It was going to be divided into like 10 toes, like 10 statues, 10 kingdoms. This beast has 10 horns, just like 10 toes. Makes sense, right? Follows in line. And so we found the divided Western Europe, and even though Rome ruled to 476 AD, by 476 AD it had been piecemealed apart by the Anglo-Saxons, the Franks, the Alemanni, the Lombards, the Ostrogoths, Heruli, Burgundies, the Visigoths, the Suebi, and the Vandals. And so they had piecemealed Rome apart, and it was gone. It didn't it collapsed from within. Remember, that's how they say Rome died. It wasn't conquered by another kingdom like all the others. It just kind of fell apart into 10. And so there we have it. So now we have another aspect of our timeline. We're in the days of divided Europe, are we not? So now we're in the timeline. We're beyond the Roman era, and now we're in the time when Rome has been divided up. So our timing is where we are. So now in Daniel chapter 7, verse 8, the Bible starts to talk about the Antichrist. So now you know where we are in time? Babylon is gone. Medo-Persia is gone. Greece is gone. Rome, pagan Rome, the big Rome is gone. And now Rome has been divided into the 10 distinct regions of divided Europe. Okay? So we're somewhere in that time frame. And then Daniel says this in verse 8. I considered the horns. So he's considering Europe as it is divided into 10. And behold, there came up among them another little horn. What's a horn in the Bible? A horn was a kingdom, right? A horn was a kingdom. So another little kingdom comes up, and it says, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots, which means they're up and they're gone and they're never coming back. And behold, in the horn were eyes like the eyes of a man and a mouth speaking great things. So now we're going to look at the Bible from Daniel's perspective, and we're going to look into Revelation's perspective, and we're going to find 15 identifying characteristics from the Bible about what the Antichrist and who the Antichrist is. But we're going to let the Bible show us what those identifiers are. We're going to see them. 1, 2, 3, 4. We're going to look at all these one at a time, and we're going to come up with 15. First of all, it came up among the 10 kingdoms. We just read that in chapter 7, verse 8. See that? It says, I beheld, and there came up among them another one. So it came up among the 10 kingdoms of Western Europe, right? So the Antichrist cannot come from America. You understand that from prophecy? The Antichrist cannot be from America because he's not part of the 10 kingdoms that divided Europe. He didn't come up among them, right? He can't come from Southern Africa because it's not part of those 10 kingdoms that Rome divided into. This horn comes up among them, which means it's within them somewhere, okay? It came up after them. All those 10 were there, and it came up afterwards, so it has to come up after 476 AD, which makes sense because if the Antichrist is here at the end of the world, right? He's not going to be here sometime in the, you know, before Jesus comes, right? And so after 476 AD, so we know it has to arise from Western Europe and after 476 AD. So far, that's the criteria the Bible's given us so far. Thirdly, and some people want to say that Antioch Epiphanes IV was the Antichrist. This is a kind of a preterist view. Preterist says all of Revelation is in the past, none of it is in the future. That's the idea of preterism. Everything is in the past and is done. They believe that Antiochus Epiphanes IV was the Antichrist. But we've seen now that the Antichrist arises after 476, right? After 476 AD, long after Jesus has come and gone. This man was born in 215 BC. He died in 164 BC. He's not even in the same century that the Antichrist arises according to Scripture. He ruled the Seleucid Empire. Was that Roman or Greek? That was Greek, right? Seleucus was one of the generals of the Greek army. So he was from the Greek era long before Rome ever took over, and Rome divided even after that, and then the little horn comes up, so he can't be the Antichrist power at all. He died in 164 BC. So Antiochus Epiphanes is not the Antichrist, and he's happy about that, right? But he doesn't care because he's dead. right? So that's it. Well, it's true. He doesn't care. Little horn power, though. The third point is that it's a little horn. It's a little horn. That's a big clue. It's not the same size as the rest of them. It's a little horn. Fourth, it would uproot three kingdoms. When we looked at that map, it said the Ostrogoths, the Vandals, and the Heruli, those three kingdoms are no longer in existence. The people groups are no longer in existence today. They were totally rooted out and destroyed by the rising power of the little horn. And so we're going to see that from history as well. It has the eyes of a man and a mouth speaking pompous words. We're going to pull three key points from this one verse. It has eyes of a man. We'll look at that shortly. But it has the mouth speaking. It has a mouth speaking. Now remember, Daniel sees this, and John saw a vision similar, and he saw a mouth speaking as well, remember? He saw a beast that was all this conglomerated beast, and its mouth was speaking as well in Revelation 13:2. And he said, the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of the bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And you look later on in chapter 13, it says, and he spoke blasphemies too with that mouth. So if the mouth is like a lion, then this beast, this power, speaks like which nation? Which nation was the lion? Babylon, right? So this nation is going to speak like Babylon. So it's going to pay for us, it's going to be beneficial for us to study how did Babylon speak and where did it get its start? Because this nation, this kingdom is going to speak like Babylon. Okay, it's going to be very much like Babylon. So let's take a look. Genesis chapter 10, verses 8 and 9, the Bible says, and Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. Now it sounds like maybe he's standing before the Lord and he's hunting for God, but that's not what those words mean. The word before, the terminology before the Lord means one who stands against. Okay, so he stood against God. He was a rebel. And that's what his name means. Nimrod means rebellious one, right? He's rebellious one, and he was a mighty one, which means literally he was a tyrant, okay? So he's a rebellious tyrant in opposition to God, okay? That's what those terminologies mean. That's exactly what that verse means. Nimrod, the rebellious one, began to be a tyrant in the earth, and he was a mighty hunter against the Lord. That's what it means. So Nimrod was not a good guy, right? And it says, in the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, which later on became Babylon. Okay, his beginning was Babel. Babel means confusion. That's what the term literally means, or the term combined means, confusion. All right, so what about this Babel? How did it work? Genesis chapter 11, verse 4 talks about them raising a tower in Babel. Anybody, you all know the Tower of Babel story. It says, and they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower. I'm going to stop there. Did you know that God planted a vineyard and built a tower in his vineyard? In Isaiah? God built a tower in his vineyard. And Babel builds a city and a tower. God has a beautiful garden, a vineyard with a tower. And Babylon, has a city and a tower as well. Opposition in place of, in behalf of, instead of God's plan. Okay. The tower in the Bible, in God's vineyard, was a symbol of the sanctuary and the process and the plan of salvation. That's what this tower symbolized in God's vineyard. Babylon has a tower too, a different way to save yourself. Really? Let us make us a name. We're not going after God's. We're not going after God's glory. We're going after our. Look at it. We're going to build a city and a tower whose top may reach into heaven. He's going to reach unto heaven because these people didn't trust the fact that God put a rainbow in the sky and said, I'll never flood the earth again. They're saying, we don't trust God. We're going to save ourselves. We're going to save ourselves. I'm not waiting for another Noah to build another ark the way that God planned us to be saved and delivered. No, no, no. We're building the tower. We're going to do it our way. Right? Lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. Listen to what they say in verse 9. Therefore, the name of it is called Babel because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth. Listen to this. It's called Babylon. It's two words in the Hebrew, Bab and El. Bab means gate. El means God. It's another gate to God. That's what Babel is. Instead of the tower, the plan of salvation that God put in his vineyard, whose center is Jesus Christ, Babel has another tower built in their city, and it's another way to heaven, another way to God. And you know, you can hear that in a lot of different places. People say, there are many ways to get to heaven. Have you ever heard that before? all roads lead. So everybody, there's so many ways to heaven. No, there's not. The Bible says there's one way, and that's through Jesus Christ, God's Son. That's what the Bible says. Matter of fact, that's what Jesus himself says in John chapter 10, verse 1. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not in by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. And in verse 9, he says, I am the door. Jesus says, look, you can't come in unless you come through me. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, shall be saved and go in and out and find pasture. Babylon, the end time Babylon, is going to speak like the old time Babylon. There's going to be a different way of salvation. It's not going to be through Jesus Christ because he says, I am the door, no other way. They're going to say there's a different tower, there's a different method of salvation. It stems from our city. This is Flavius Josephus. He's a historian, a Jewish historian, quite accurate actually. And this isn't the Bible, but it's interesting, very curious. Now it was Nimrod who excited them to such an affront and contempt of God. He was the grandson of Ham, the son of Noah, a bold man and of great strength of hand. He persuaded them not to ascribe it to God as if it were through his means they were happy, but to believe that it was their own courage which procured happiness. God hasn't given you anything. It's been your own stubborn goodwill, your good works, all of the things that you have done have made you happy. You are a self-made man or woman. That's the kind of idea that this, you know, there's a statue in Boulder, Colorado. We lived just a couple miles from Boulder for many years. And as you're coming down into Boulder, well, you got to take a couple side roads. But anyway, you're coming into Boulder, and there's this statue. And it's in this square, and it is this big stone. And there's this, they carved out of it a man from the waist up, and he has a hammer in one hand and a chisel in the other, and he's chiseling himself out of the rock. That's the implication. And the title is Self-Made Man. Are you self-made man or woman? Or did God make you? God made you, folks. God made you. And God made you who you are, and he's given everything that you have to you. Everything you have, everything you are, everything you ever will be or ever will have is a gift from the gracious and almighty God. And he sustains you, and he keeps you, and he loves you. Even those who've turned their back on him, he gives them everything they need every day. The sun and the rain, their food, their shelter. He gives it to them too because he's merciful and he loves them and he's trying to win them back to him. He's trying to win them. It's not our own courage that's procured us happiness. It's the grace and the love of our God. He also gradually changed the government to tyranny, seeing that no other way of turning men from the fear of God but to bring them into a constant dependence upon his power. Think of this, folks. He wants to turn men from the fear of God, from obeying God. That's what that term means, fearing God. Turn them away from obeying God and by bringing them into a constant dependence upon his power. Dependence upon his government. Okay? That not you, but the government will supply you your food. The government will be responsible to supply you your tuition for college. The government will supply you your health care. The government will supply you your retirement. The government will supply you with work if you can't work, that kind of thing. He brought them into constant dependence upon his power, and it was the only way he could see to keep them from fearing God. Does that sound fairly familiar to the world we're living in today? People being turned into dependence upon somebody other than God? Yeah, it is. It's happening again today. Nimrod was later on died, and he was deified, which means they made him a god, which doesn't mean anything to us, but to them it did. And he was worshipped as Marduk and Baal and Osiris. His wife, Semiramis, was also worshipped as Astarte, Ashtoreth, Ishtar, Aphrodite, Queen of Heaven. And the reason I put those in there is this. John saw this vision of this conglomerated beast, right? All of these beasts smashed together into one. Mutilated, it wasn't mutilated, it was all put together with different parts. Daniel saw individuals, boom, 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 going down the line. It wasn't just the kingdoms that were passing along, but the doctrines and the teachings as well. And so when John sees this beast, he's not just seeing the consummation of history up to his time. What he's seeing is the building of false doctrines and the compiling of all this false teaching and all these different gods. Because when Babylon was conquered by Medo-Persia, Medo-Persia took the religion of Babylon and enfolded it into their own, and it blended in. And then when Greece conquered Medo-Persia, they enfolded all all of the beliefs of Medo-Persia into the Grecian ideas and all the different pantheons. And Rome did the same thing. And by the time Rome came, they had hundreds and hundreds of gods in the pantheon. You had a god for everything, and sometimes two, right? And they were all not after God. They're all fashioned after you and I. Sinful, lustful, violent, drunken. They had created gods after their own image instead of remembering that God created us after His. And so John sees this entire cacophony, this entire disaster of false theology, false teachings just coming together. And he's looking at it, and he's like, I can't even describe this thing. All of this stuff is put together. That's why he sees it all smashed together. And that's why we see the same types of beliefs passed down from society to society through time all the way to where we are today. Nebuchadnezzar, how did Babylon speaking in the Daniel's day? Daniel knew much about how Nebuchadnezzar spoke and how Babylon spoke. Nebuchadnezzar, he saw that image from God, head of gold, chest and arms of silver, and he's like, wait a minute, I don't want Babylon to end. So he made a statue, an image that was entirely gold. So Babylon will rule forever. But you know what? No plan of man can disrupt the plan of God. God said, look, this is the way history is going to go. God has said it. That's the way it's going to be. You and I can't change it. And so Nebuchadnezzar tried, and he said, look, I'm making this image, and I want you, and that's very important language, by the way. It says there's an image, okay? The Revelation talks about an image in Babylon as well at the end of time. Not in the literal city of Babylon, but it's a Babylonian image. Those whoso falleth not down and worship, what was the issue there too? Worship. Fall down and worship shall be the same hour be cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Does that sound like tyranny to you? You either worship my image or you're going to die, right? That was the speaking of Babylon. So when we think of this mouth that speaks, we have to think of how Babylon spoke in the past. Babylon, this fallen little horn power, is going to speak just that way at the end of time. God's not giving us all these clues just to be, oh yeah, we'll just call it Babylon here too, and we'll call it Babylon there too. No. Those are all there for a reason, folks. It's to enlighten us, to help us understand what God is saying. This is how it's going to be at the end of time. And we have to be very, very serious about our Bible study, folks, because Babylon is going to speak again. Eyes like the eyes of a man. Number five, same verse. It has eyes of a man. The Bible tells us that our eyes are our understanding. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 8, may the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. So this power, this little horn, has the wisdom or understanding that is man-centered, not God-centered. It's man-centric, not God-centric. And it's also from man. So it's man's wisdom and not based on God's wisdom. Okay? So that's what that tells us right there. And that's an important clue as well. It'll also be diverse or different. Daniel 7, verse 24 means it's going to be different than the other kingdoms. Okay? We're going to find out what that means. It speaks great words or blasphemies against the Most High. That word was also there in chapter 7, verse 8. And in 24, it speaks of it. In Revelation 13, 5, it says it's going to speak blasphemy. What is blasphemy? Because that's going to be important for us to know. This lion mouth is going to speak blasphemy. Well, the Bible tells us what blasphemy means. So remember, we let the Bible interpret the Bible. We don't grab, you know, things from here and there. We let the Bible tell us what the Bible means. What is blasphemy? Luke chapter 5, verse 21. Take your Bible and go to Luke chapter 5, verse 21. Luke chapter 5, verse 21. The Bible gives us two definitions of blasphemy. Luke chapter 5, verse 21. The Bible says they're contending with Jesus. He's healed a paralytic. And in verse 20, he had said, he saw their faith and said unto them, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. That's what Jesus says in verse 20. Verse 21, and the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this which speaketh blasphemy? Who can forgive sin but God alone? And they're right, only God can forgive sin. But of course, they're wrong about Jesus because Jesus was God, right? So he had the power to forgive sin. They were wrong, but they were right. They're saying, look, you're a man and you're claiming the power to forgive sin. That's only God's prerogative. God alone can forgive. That's blasphemy if you're a man and you claim the power to forgive sin. And according to the Bible, claiming the power to forgive sin, if you're a man, I don't see God here personally. So none of us have the power to forgive sin. I can forgive you your offense against me. If you step on my toe, I can forgive you. But I can't forgive you your sin against God. Only God can do that. Right? Only God can do that. What's another definition of blasphemy? Comes from John chapter 10, verse 33, claiming to be God. The Jews answered him, saying, "For a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, because thou, being a man, makest thyself God." A man who claims to be God, that claim to be God is blasphemy. So the Bible has two definitions for blasphemy. One is claiming to be God, and one is a man claiming the power to forgive sin. Okay, both which are God. God's prerogative and God himself, and no man takes his place. And so those two things make sense because those are anti-Christos. They are instead of or in behalf of or in the place of Christ. They're in place of God. They're saying, look, I'm gonna be God, or I'm going to forgive you sins. Right? They're standing in the place of God. So both of those definitions fall in the line of anti-Christos, antichrist. All right, identifying characteristic number 8. It's going to be wearing out the saints. In Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, it said it would wear out the saints, meaning it's a persecuting power against God's people. The 9th point in Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, turn there for us. We'll look at this verse together because I don't know if we've read this together. Daniel chapter 7, verse 25. Daniel 7, verse 25, there the Bible says, "And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time, times, and a dividing of time." So he's going to wear out the saints, meaning he's going to be a persecuting power. He's going to think to change times and laws. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Do you think God really cares about the law, the speed limit law here in Detroit Lakes? Do you think he's concerned about it? It could be 15, it could be 30, it could be 50. He's not really concerned about it, right? Whose laws do you think God is concerned with? His laws, right? His laws. And his times. Remember that word times is prophetic times. He's saying, look, don't mess with the times that I've set up that things are going to happen. Because this is the way things are. God has timing set for everything. And he says that word times is prophetic. It's a prophetic time. So people are going to think to change times and God's law. And the 10th point is that they would rule for a time, times, and a half a time. How long is that? How much time is that, right? How much time is that? It's a pretty good. How much time is it? It's one time plus two times, right? Times is double. So it's a time plus two times. It's three and a half a time. So it's three and a half times. What is a time? A time is a year. In the Bible, it's Old English for 1 year. Time, it oftentimes used in the Bible, is a time. The Bible calendar had 30 days in a month, 360 days in a year, prophetically. So you have 3.5 years equals 1,260 days. 1,260 days. Revelation chapter 13, verse 5 says 42 months. 42 times 30 is 1,260. It's the same time frame. So whenever you see these 3.5 years, 1,260 days, 42 months, you see this time frame, time times and half a time, it's always talking about the same time frame. God has given that key to us so we can say, hey, this is the time frame. This is this time. This is the time when the Antichrist is ruling. Okay, and all the way through Scripture, in Daniel and Revelation, God shows us that time again and again and again in different prophecies, so we know exactly where we are in time, because God wants us to know where we are in time. So how much is 1,260 days? Because remember, we're symbolic prophecy. We were in a symbolic prophecy a few nights ago, and we discovered that in symbolic prophecy, time isn't what it looks like, right? And the Bible gives us a key. In Ezekiel 4:6, God says, "I have appointed thee a day for each year." So symbolically, a day is a literal year. So the Antichrist power is not going to rule for 1,260 days, but 1,260 years. Now, some of you are like, wait a minute, that's a lot longer than I thought he was going to, right? And it was to me too. I'm like, wait a minute, but that's exactly what the Bible is saying. The little horn power is going to be in power for 1,260 years. Not 3.5 years, but 1,260 years, according to Bible prophecy. 11th item is the deadly wound to its head would be healed. There in Revelation 13:3, "And I saw one of its heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed." We're going to look at that and see exactly what that means. All right, so let's kind of summarize what we've gotten so far. We've gone through 11 of them so far. Let's kind of get this put into perspective here. So we know it comes up from among Western Europe because it had to come up among those 10 horns. It comes up after 476 AD because after the fall of Rome, after the dividing of Rome. It would be a little kingdom. It would uproot three kingdoms while rising to power, right? The Ostrogoths, the Vandals, and the Heruli were destroyed by the rising of this power. It would have eyes of the man, meaning it has man's wisdom. It would be diverse or different than other powers. It would speak blasphemies against the Most High, and blasphemy is two things in the Bible. One is claiming to be God, and the other is claiming the power to do what? Forgive sin, right? Claiming the power to be God and claiming to forgive sin. It would wear out the saints, which means it's going to persecute the people who are holding on to the word of God. It would think to change times, prophetic times, and think to change God's laws. It would rule for 1,260 years, which the Bible says is a time, times, and half a time, or 42 months. And its deadly wound it would receive to one of its heads, but it would be healed. Okay, those are the 11 we have so far. Who could it be? We have 4 points left. You're going to have to come back tomorrow night and find out. I'm tired of talking tonight. I'm not really, but you might be tired of listening. But we want to put it in perspective. So when you leave tonight, remember, God is very particular in prophecy. He doesn't leave you swimming around in confusion. God has given us the understanding so that we can be knowledgeable, so we can be forewarned. That's why Jesus would told them, look, I've told you beforehand, so you know. I've told you beforehand, so you know. And so we too can be told beforehand. We must know, my friends. We must know because you and I, we're living in the days when the mark of the beast is going to be shown upon us. It's going to be pushed upon us. I truly believe we're living in a day when the mark of the beast is going to be pushed upon the world. I truly believe it with all my heart. Now, I could be wrong, and I might die before that happens, and that's not going to shake my faith at all because with a day with God is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. So, but you know, I'm seeing an awful lot of prophecy happening around us, and we're going to see more of it as we go through. Exactly the way God said it was going to be just before everything stops. And I want to encourage you, study the Word. Study the Word. Read the Bible. Read these texts. Read Daniel chapter 7 tonight. Read Revelation 13. Prepare yourself for what we're going to study tomorrow night because you're not getting an outline tonight, by the way. Because you're going to get one tomorrow night because it has the entire thing together. And we're halfway through, and I hated to give you half of an outline, so I'm going to give you a whole outline tomorrow. And it's a few pages longer, of course, but you're going to have it tomorrow. So I want you to come tomorrow night, study the Word of God with us again. Remember, God tells us this not because He wants to be the know-it-all and He wants to shock people, but because He loves you, right? He loves you, and He loves His people, and He loves all the creation of earth, and He's trying to save as many as He possibly can. Let's have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, thank you that we've had your word to open up tonight. Lord, we thank you for the freedom to have your word. We thank you for the ability to gather together to share your word and study and pray. We pray for protection for that freedom. And Lord, we pray that as we leave this place, that your spirit will go with each and every one of us, that you will guide us in our lives. Lord, that you will lead us day by day into a closer walk with you, that we will not be dissuaded to go to the left or to the right, but we will stay firmly fixed with our eyes upon Jesus. And Lord, we pray that you would watch between us all. Lord, bring us back together tomorrow to study your word again. We thank you for being here tonight with us. We thank you for your promise that wherever we go, you will be with us, even unto the ends of the earth. And in Jesus' name we ask, amen. Lord be with you tonight. Remember, you can leave this place, but you can never go so far to be beyond the reach of God's love. He loves you. He cares for you. He's always loved you. God bless you and good night.